Good evening. I want to explain the title a little bit. Many things have already been written and said about the question of high and low art. That means the relationship between so-called high art, sculpture, painting, and so on, and low art, popular culture, advertisement, photography, family photographs, packaging, comic books, graffiti, etc. So many things that one could imagine, but the matter is has been settled once and for all. But I have the idea that that's what I would like to develop this evening, that at least one of the aspects of popular culture has been underestimated as to its influence on modern and contemporary art. And that aspect is the cartoon. And the Dan Perzhovsky exhibition here shows an additional evidence that what I propose to call the cartoon paradigm has a great influence in contemporary art. I don't use the word paradigm to be redundant. That means something like a pattern or an example, but I think it's the right word. I would like to go a little back a while in history, in an attempt to understand in which way the cartoon concept was essential in art during all the 20th century. And this through two major examples, among many others I could have chosen. The two examples are Marcel Duchamp, of course, and the American artist Ad Reinhardt. Both of them are usually regarded as grandfathers for contemporary art. When portraying the beginning of Marcel Duchamp as an artist, one usually refers to his presentation of a nude descending a staircase and the refusal of a painting by the Salon des Indépendants in Paris in 1912. Here is a funny, even a cartoon by André Raffray who shows Marcel Duchamp taking back his unaccepted picture out of the Salon in 1912. So this refusal was certainly a painful event in the Duchamp's career, and one can assume that the very solitary attitude of Duchamp during all his lifetime was triggered at that precise moment of the refusal of a painting. And the reasons and the circumstances of the refusal are still not very clear. There are several hypotheses about the refusal. One classic hypothesis is that the picture had been too modern, had gone too far on the path of movement decomposition. I think we can discard this theory because the Futurist Manifesto had been published in Paris just 3 years before. Many Futurist paintings by Balla or some other artists had been exhibited in Paris. Photographers as Marais, Muybridge were very well known in Paris at the time, especially by the art students. And if you look at what was shown at the Salon des Indépendants, you have, let's say, academic paintings, academic cubist paintings by Le Fauconnier or Delaunay, who went at as far as Duchamp's nude. So that cannot be the reason. The second reason could be that the picture had been refused because of its close resemblance to a schema you can find at the time in a student book. It was a schema by Paul Richer. He was a teacher at the Fine Art School in Paris, and Duchamp knew him, not because of the Fine Art School, but because Duchamp's father was a lawyer, and he was the lawyer of Paul Richer, the teacher at the Fine Art School. And you see the two images are very similar. So that may be that sounds nearer to truth that, than the first reason. But the third reason, and here we are at the heart of the question of the cartoon, the reason which is usually accepted and given by Duchamp himself is that the problem was linked with the title, Nude Descending a Staircase, and the fact that the title was inscribed on the canvas. If this is the real reason why the painting was refused, the question remains, why should the title be so scandalous? It's an innocent pun on the classical expressions, reclining nude, standing nude, and etc. Visually, it's extremely discreet. If you see the picture, it's at the bottom of the canvas in dark letters. You don't see the title immediately. Was it so shocking, even in 1912? Seen from today's standpoint, it's impossible to understand. But if we go back a little bit into history, we can understand why this title was regarded as shocking, and that's the art of a topic. The main fear of the salon organizers was to become victims of a joke, of what you would call today hoax. That fear is related to the fact that 2 years before, in 1910, they were victims of magnificent hoax. You probably know the story. Two journalists, one was to become a very famous writer in France, Roland Dorgelès, submitted to the salon, to the jury, that painting called Sunset Over the Adriatic. It was supposed to be a painting by a Italian futurist painter, Joachim Boronelli. And this picture was proven to have been painted with a brush attached to the tail of a donkey. And a photograph of the making of the painting was published in a newspaper. So you can imagine how much the people of the salon were flabbergasted with the hoax. And why was, I think I have another image, yes. Why was Duchamp specially suspected in that case? Because at that time, he was a cartoonist. He was working for the satirical press in Paris as a cartoonist and humoristic draftsman. His brothers did too, but Duchamp was a trick player, and he was everybody was afraid of him because of that. What did Duchamp's cartoons look like? Liliane and Michel Durand-Desser, who were very prominent art dealers in Paris in the 1980s, and who were art historians too, made a very, very precise research on Marcel Duchamp's cartoons. In 1975, they published something about that, and practically everyone was completely oblivious to this question. Most of the cartoons were published in that newspaper, Le Courrier Français. Your courrier, it's mail in English, but the same kind of mail as in the Daily Mail, for instance. Some were published in Le Rire. Le Rire, that means laughter in French. And one was published in Le Témoin, witness, the witness in English. And some of them were shown in an exhibition in Rouen. Let me show you some of the drawings. I tried to do a short best of among the about 20 drawings Duchamp published in the newspapers. You will notice that they are not really funny, not so funny. Most of them are, I have to say, have bad ones. And that's not a question of translation. They are not so funny in French too. I try to go quickly, but I try to be precise. But one example, the caption in French means feminism, the woman priest, and it's a very bad pun. It's a dirty pun about abortion, because curé in French has several meanings and can have that kind of meaning. You have also that. The caption is, if I had known he wasn't coming, I would have ordered only one beer. Of course, the man she was waiting was supposed to pay. Here, it's typical of what Duchamp did at the time. It's a play on words. Is the cod well desalted? In English, that doesn't mean anything, but in French, morue is one of the innumerable words in slang to say a woman, and desalted means sexually well experienced. Why did you want me to call you daddy 1 minute ago? It's no comment. Here is a famous one, maybe the most well known, because usually people don't know it's just a cartoon, it's not a work, an artwork. And the caption is longer, gifts for old gentlemen, this doll can walk, close her eyes, blow kisses with her two hands, is completely articulate, small hat, silk dress, lace underwear, she undresses completely, and here, je marche, tu parles, I walk, you speak. Okay, let's go faster. This one is about how to kiss a lady. This one is almost impossible to understand today. It's related to a contemporary event. It was a very famous trial in Paris. A woman had killed both her husband, her mother, and maybe someone else, and everybody wanted to see what she looked like, and so, have you seen her? She asked to the soldier, have you seen her? It's that criminal. Here is a very bad play on words, no need to translate. Button up your vest, it's the maid. It's almost impossible to translate, it would take too long. And this is the last, but last but not least, and definitely the worst cartoon by Marcel Duchamp, the caption says, "Are you Jewish?" And the answer is, "Why not? It's a profession like any other." It's very strange to see that today, but Duchamp was not at all anti-Semite, and he proved it afterwards. But in the beginning of the 19th century in France, anti-Semitism was a very common ideology, and especially among anarchists and leftists, and most of the satirical reviews were anarchist. So it's very sad to admit that, but it's the truth. And Jacques Villon, Duchamp's brother, drawings were even worse on that for that matter. Of course, we are in 1910. We are 30 years before the Nazi extermination plan, but we have to think also that we are after the Dreyfus affair, and unfortunately, it was usual in France, and one of the first anti-Semitic theorists was Drumont. He was French. So I wanted to show everything, even that drawing. You may ask, if the drawings by Duchamp were meant for morons, if they are so bad, why should we give any attention to them, one being especially politically incorrect? I think that considered alone, the cartoons by Duchamp are not so important. But if you bear in mind that if you bear in mind the entire work by Duchamp, you can see, at least in my opinion, that what I propose to call the cartoon paradigm that Duchamp experienced in his youth, that cartoon paradigm reappears in practically all his work during all his lifetime. I try to give you some examples. The simplest example is the postcard of a Gioconda with a beard and a mustache, made in 1919 and first published by Picabia, as you probably know, and Picabia forgot the beard. You know that by heart, the pun L-H-O-O-Q in French means phonetically something like she's horny. I'm sorry, that's Duchamp speaking, not me. Duchamp did many puns of the same kind, in which you can hear and create complete sentences with simple letters when you spell them. If you have children, you know that all the teenagers today do that on their cell phones. They just write U2 for U2 or 2B3 for to be free. It's usual now. And Duchamp did many plays on words of the same kind. For instance, L-H-O-Q, of course, but some are less known. I-R-G, essuyer des cuillères, in French that means yesterday I wiped spoons, that doesn't mean anything. But I love the last one, M-O-A, j'ai baisé des S-O-Z-S-L-A-R-E-N-U, and that means, and I fucked goddesses with fresh and naked armpits. And In the that kind of play on words was very usual in the satirical press at the time. These drawings, for instance, were published for the Salon des Incohérents, was a satirical salon in Paris. La et ou u, have you seen him or her or it. And here FL in French, if you spell the letters, that means that sounds like Gustave Eiffel of the Eiffel Tower. And the idea of playing with a Gioconda was very usual in the press at the time too. If you look, you can find a Gioconda with a moustache in Le Rire in 1908. Don't forget that was the newspaper where Duchamp published, and it was made that drawing 10 years before the Gioconda by Marcel Duchamp. And you can find also drawings of the same kind in the same review a little bit later. And here a Gioconda in modern attire in L'Assiette au Beurre, which is another satirical well-known review. I could show you innumerable drawings of the same kind. As you probably know, the Gioconda had been stolen in the Louvre in Paris in just a century ago by an Italian worker who kept the Gioconda under his bed for 3 years. And it was when it was rediscovered, the picture was rediscovered, there were hundreds of drawings in all the press on the subject at the time. So, if you look at that example, and if you think of some other ones, you can understand that many of Duchamp's works are really jokes. Sometimes they are philosophical jokes, as, for instance, Fountain, the urinal. And these jokes are in line with the humor of a satirical press he worked for during 2 years. He loved to play tricks, and that's the reason, I assume, why he was so suspect, and why the nude descending a staircase was refused. That's just because of Duchamp's reputation. But the point is, I think, elsewhere. What you have seen, what I have shown you, are cartoons. That doesn't mean caricatures. The two forms are not the same at all. A caricature is a special way to render a funny shape to a face or a figure by emphasizing certain features of the face. What you have on the screen is a caricature. It's a special kind of draftsman art, how to make portraits both unfaithful and faithful to reality. That's what is very interesting in caricature. It's unfaithful to reality, but if you have a bad photograph of somebody and a good caricature, it's easier to recognize a person on a caricature than on a bad photograph. And that's the reason why you laugh at the caricature. It's very funny to be at the same time faithful to reality and completely unfaithful to the same reality. And a cartoon is completely different from a caricature. It's the drawing doesn't matter so much. To be precise, it matters, of course, but the drawing can be very simple and even unskillfully done and still work. My hero, my personal hero in the staff of the New Yorker, the American Review, my personal hero is a draftsman named James Thurber, you probably know him. His drawings are really unskillful. He was, at the beginning in the New Yorker, he was a caption writer. The two jobs were often separate. You had caption writers and draftsmen. And James Thurber, who was a caption writer, decided to draw himself, and he did those splendid cartoons. I like very much that one. Well, if I call the wrong number, why did you answer the phone? And so the drawing is very ordinary, but the cartoons are magnificent. And at the beginning of the century, so earlier, most of the cartoons were very, very academic and conventional drawings. If you take if you take out the captions in Duchamp's cartoons, you will see they are ordinary drawings, neither good nor bad, just academic drawings. And a cartoon is merely a drawing with a caption, which work together, and you can't separate them. If you do, if you separate the caption and the drawing, you lose the essence of a cartoon, and that's very important. If you look at two major works by Duchamp, not that one, okay, the large glass, and the series of the ready-mades, you will understand that the cartoon paradigm, a drawing working with words and words working with a drawing, are that this paradigm is active in both cases, in the case of the large glass and in the case of the ready-mades. Why for the large glass? Because the large glass, which is, as you know, in Philadelphia, works with the green box and the white box later, and these boxes are in a way directions for use made by Duchamp for the large glass. Duchamp himself said that a spectator has to be in front of the large glass, a reader and a spectator in the same at the same time. And many people spent sometimes a lifetime to try to decipher the notes, the instructions for use, to understand the plan of the large glass. And even more interesting, in my opinion, is the to notice the relation between the question of the ready-mades and the question of the cartoon. That's always the same problem. So much has been said over the question of the first ready-mades that everyone imagines there is nothing more to add. That's not correct. I think there are a lot of things to say about the ready-mades. And for instance, to say that the first ready-mades by Duchamp were really very, very closely related to writing. You know, when Duchamp found the word ready-made, he just arrived in the United States, and he didn't speak English at the time. He just discovered the word in 1916, and at the time, the ready-made wasn't exactly what we think today it is. What we think today a ready-made is related to the definition given in the Dictionnaire abrégé du surréalisme, Surrealism Short Dictionary, and this definition was not given by Duchamp himself. It was written by André Breton and Paul Éluard. And that definition is ready-made, is an ordinary object elevated to the dignity of a work of art by the mere choice of the artist. An artist choose an object, decides it's a work of art, and it becomes a work of art. And that's not the way it goes. In the very beginning, Duchamp gave a definition of a ready-made in a letter he sent to his sister, Suzanne, his beloved sister, Suzanne. I read it quickly, but I read it. If you have been to my place, so she is in Paris, he is in New York, and he asked her to visit his studio in Paris. If you have been to my place, you will have seen in the studio a bicycle wheel and a bottle rack. I bought this as a ready-made sculpture. And I have a plan concerning this so-called bottle rack. Listen to this. Here in New York, I have bought various objects of the same taste, and I treat them as ready-mades. You know enough English to understand the meaning of ready-made that I give to these objects. I sign them, and I think of an inscription for them in English. As an example, he gives the inscription he made on the snow shovel in advance of the broken arm. Nobody knows which sentence was intended for the bottle rack. Duchamp always claimed that he had forgotten the proposal for a sentence. Probably Duchamp didn't forget anything, his memory was very good. But it's likely that he was not satisfied with the sentence later, and that he preferred to leave things mysterious, as he did very often. The point here is that originally, the ready-made was not only an object chosen by an artist, it was a chosen object, but with a sentence, let's say a caption, written on it. For in advance of the broken arm, the pun is quite evident. You can easily broke your arm using a snow shovel to wipe away the snow before your house. For another ready-made, it's more mysterious. That's the so-called dog comb. The caption, en français, trois ou quatre gouttes de hauteur n'ont rien à faire avec, avec la sauvagerie, in English, three or four drops of height have nothing to do with savagery. This sentence doesn't mean anything, even in French. It's pure nonsense, like the puns you can find in Edward Lear writings or Lewis Carroll books. And the reason why it chose such nonsense is probably the fact that Arensberg, the collector, was mad with cryptography. His hobby was to look in the Dante or Shakespeare's work hidden meanings, and Duchamp was very skeptical about this hobby, and it's the caption on the ready-made is probably another trick, a friendly trick towards the collector, towards Arensberg. So, if you admit that the cartoon stands at the lowest level of in the hierarchy of the arts, as the simplest way to change the meaning of an image with words, or to change the meaning of words just with an image, that's what I call the cartoon paradigm, it's not at all absurd to say that Duchamp drew more or less sophisticated cartoons all his life. New descending a staircase had trouble not because of a picture but because of a caption. The green box is the caption for the large glass, and a ready-made is basically an object with a caption directly written on it. So the cartoon pattern or paradigm is not revealed in Duchamp's work alone, even if, always in my opinion, it's fundamental, Duchamp, in this respect. For instance, the very famous, "This is not a pipe" by Magritte, is obviously a cartoon. It's a philosophical one too, the question being here, does the caption "This is not a pipe" apply to the object that the picture imitates, or does the caption apply to the canvas where the object is painted? And in the first case, the caption is a lie: this is a canvas, this is not a pipe. And in the second one, the caption is true: it's a canvas, it's not a pipe. And you are locked in the trap between word and image, words and images. And Michel Foucault wrote magnificent pages on this very simple work. And many examples could be found in modern art history, but one case is especially interesting for us, but the case of Ad Reinhardt. You are familiar, I imagine, with this abstract American painter. He was born in 1913, and he started abstract painting very early, in the 1930s. He was only 27 when he began to paint abstract. And he went on to be famous with his black paintings in the 1960s. The black paintings, you know them. They are paintings at the end of the 60s, always the same size, 5 feet by 5 feet, and divided into 9 identical squares in very slightly different use of black. And Reinhardt gave his own definition for these black paintings, and I show you the definition. A black painting is a clearly defined object, independent and separate from all other objects and circumstances, in which we cannot depict whatever we choose or make of it, anything we want, whose meaning is not detachable or translatable, from it, from which nothing can be added nor removed, a free, unmanipulated and unmanipulatable, useless, unmarketable, irreducible, unphotographable, unreproducible, inexplicable icon, a non-entertainment, not for art commerce or mass media art public, non-expressionist, not for oneself. of course, such a crazy statement suggests that the idea of the picture is much more important, but the picture, and which is exactly what minimal or conceptual artists such as Lawrence Weiner, for instance, or Kossuth perceived. And that's the reason which explains why these artists chose Reinhardt as their spiritual father, the spiritual father of conceptual art. And as you probably know too, Ad Reinhardt drew in the 40s many cartoons for a review called Picture Magazine. It was an independent American periodical. And these cartoons all carry the same title. It's a series of how to look at. They are short but very efficient demonstrations. You probably know that image. A guy look at an abstract painting, what does this represent? And the abstract painting replies, what do you represent? But it's very well known, but it's only a detail of a larger cartoon, which is how to look at a cubist painting. This is the first one. It's very sophisticated. It would be too long, of course, to read everything. And many of the same kind were to follow. You have how to see high abstract art, how to see or how to look at low surrealist art. And Reinhardt didn't like surrealist art. You have, I adore that one, how to look at a spiral, how to look at an artist, and you have also how to look at an art talk, but I forgot the photo. And of course, each of these drawings merits special and precise analysis, but it would take too long. Let's choose only one example. That's how to look at modern art in America. It's partly an ordinary cartoon, a funny one. I like very much the small detail. At the bottom on the left, that's a baby shark fight between art and business. And some details are very precise and related to the context of the years where the cartoons were made. Here, the falling leaves of the family tree of American art are artists who chose to left abstraction to go back toward realism. Elion was a French painter, and he did that. He began as an abstract artist and became a realist one. And here, the one of the main branches of the family tree of American art is about to crack. Because of the weight of all that Reinhardt perceived as a danger, the subject matter, the Mexican influence, and that was perceived as major threats at the time, because Ad Reinhardt was a leftist, and the left side of American artists chose realism as the only art form valuable for a socialist society, and of course Ad Reinhardt didn't like that idea. But one shouldn't regard Reinhardt's cartoon as only ironical. You have at the time many ironical drawings about the modern art. The art was a favorite topic for or a subject for many cartoonists at the time, especially in the New Yorker, exactly at the same time when the Ad Reinhardt cartoons were published. You can see I chose two examples. This one is quite demagogic. I'm not going to be the one to tell them it's a ventilator, and it's easy, of course. I like very much that one, which is extremely poetic. Of course, the sunset is a Roscoe. So it can be funny and poetic. And the question here is, what kind of role did the cartoons play in the Ad Reinhardt's career? Reinhardt is not, and it's maybe sometimes difficult to understand that, he's not a kind of Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde doing modern art during the day and mocking it at night. Ad Reinhardt's intentions are clearly pedagogical ones, and even more militant ones. He wants modern art to be understood, and what he does with the cartoons, its explanations, and all the theory of how to look at, and especially how to look at modern art in America, is a reply to the very famous family tree made by Alfred Barr for his exhibition at the MoMA in 1938. It's a classical family tree. And one must say that despite the ironical dimension of the Reinhardt family tree, his family tree is much more subtle and complex, and in a way much more correct than the Alfred Barr's family tree. I have a great admiration for Alfred Barr, that's not the question, but his family tree here is a Darwinian model for the evolution of art. And what you see here, which is very well known, is the second state of the schema by Alfred Barr. At the very beginning, the schema of modern art evolution wasn't a family tree. It was a torpedo. It was a torpedo because it was intended to prove that the head of modern art was in America. It was true, but it was everybody knows that things are more not so simple. And what I like in Reinhardt drawings is that Reinhardt shows that everything is more complicated than in the Alfred Barr torpedo. And Reinhardt shows that with humor. And that's not a coincidence. What is less known about Ad Reinhardt is that, exactly as did Duchamp, he actually began his career as a cartoonist, not as an artist, as a cartoonist. And he was a quite successful cartoonist at the beginning. One of my best students at the Fine Art School in Paris, David Rybak, did his PhD on this question, and I borrow from him, with his permission, of course, some information about the early Reinhardt. Reinhardt was, I said it, a left-wing militant in the 30s when he was still a student at Columbia University, and most of the drawings were about politics and social progress, equality. First ones were published in a review called Jester, that was the students' magazine of Columbia University. This one is a critic of, those universities' brotherhoods and the kind of mafia that the alumni of great universities in the United States represent. Reinhardt was a pacifist. Can see it in that drawing, students fight war. It was made for the Student League, it was a pacifist organization at the time. Sometimes he went really very far in his pacific convictions. For instance, this cover was made for the Jester, and it's very strange to, if you look carefully at the cartoon, you can see that the different faces made a swastika, the Nazi sign, and you can recognize Hitler above and on the left, and just below Mussolini. But what is disturbing is that the other faces are the ones of Herbert Hoover and Franklin Roosevelt, American presidents, one Republican, one Democrat. And both of them were against isolationism in the United States, and Reinhardt was for isolationism. The pacifists were against the involvement of the United States in war in Europe. So, what to think about what can we think today about such a drawing? Anyway, the censorship let the drawing pass the exam, if I can say that, but another one was censored. It represents the dean, the president of Columbia University, beating children, and the reason why he did that is that Butler, that's the name of the president, was a Republican, and he was fighting against a law against the children labor in supposedly for freedom's sake. The drawing had been published, but elsewhere. It's obvious that even on a stylistical level, the political cartoons of Reinhardt influenced the how to look at series. This one, which is smart and funny, different the succession of different systems, monarchy, the first capitalism, and after that the socialism, is very close in his way to function, very close to the how to look at cubist art. You can detect the same kind of visual trick and the same way of pointing fingers. Ad Reinhardt didn't forget the earlier cartoons when he did the art cartoons. And what is very interesting is that after, let's say, 1947 or 1948, Reinhardt did only a few cartoons. He did four, to be precise, for Art News. And one could imagine that Reinhardt abandoned cartoons because he was fed up with them or tired with them, or that he regarded the genre of the cartoon as unimportant in regard of the black paintings. But this would be also a mistake. The truth is that he had been fired from Picture Magazine because of his cartoons, because the cartoons were too polemical. And after that, after he was fired from the review, he had very few opportunities to publish other cartoons. And he was forbidden to continue his way in the cartoon. That means, in a way, that escaped the art market and the global ideology of the time. And Reinhardt was perfectly aware of the situation. That's what he said about the fact he stopped to do cartoons. I have done many cartoons or satires for a long time because it doesn't seem possible. The art world is no longer satirizable. I suppose there is not much going on except business, and that's not very funny. 10 or 15 years ago, it was possible to call another artist an old war. It's not possible anymore. And actually, had Reinhardt's problem was that he was, let's say, both an insider and an outsider at the same time. With the black paintings, the very well-known black paintings, he was a member of the artist's staff of Betty Parsons, a very famous and influential gallery. And so he was an insider. And with the cartoons, he was suspicious as an outsider. It's very difficult to make one's, it's a simple problem. It's very difficult to make one's living with cartoons and as an outsider. I'm afraid to be too long, but I like to explain to my students that Duchamp never turned to be rich. The first car he bought, it was in 68. He was 80 years old, and it was not a Mercedes Benz or a Cadillac. It was a Volkswagen Beetle. But he stayed free, and he didn't enter the art market. And the Reinhardt's position was different. He was not completely an outsider. He was insider and outsider. Of course, Duchamp's intentions and Reinhardt's intentions were different. Duchamp didn't want to hear about politics. Reinhardt was involved in political struggles, but their work has the same characteristic, which could be summed up in the architect Mies van der Rohe statement, less is more. That's the philosophy of the cartoon. That means less work for Duchamp, less colors for Reinhardt, and less illusions for both of them. And one can be sure that the school for that kind of, let's say, time-saving was for both of them, the cartoon, and especially a good cartoon, is always something that can be seen as very efficient, but also very minimal. And I don't wish to dwell too much on Berejovsky, because you certainly had the occasion to consider his work more than I have, but obviously many links can be found between the works of Duchamp, Reinhardt, and Berejovsky. For instance, especially on the minimal side of artwork that cartoons authorize. When a critic asks to Berejovsky the question of what comes first, the text or the image, he replies, and I quote, "They both come at once. I have such dexterity now that I draw as I talk. Image and text are interrelated. Because I use a minimal vocabulary, a square can signify a tableau, a museum, a house, a TV, or a room. I just have to name it." And that's exactly the definition of the philosophical virtue of the cartoon. Because it makes text and image work together, it can be extremely efficient just in an instant. Berejovsky doesn't quote Duchamp or Reinhardt as an influence, but he quotes the art scene in the 60s and the 70s, that means in a period where artists refused the fetishism of artwork and the economic system based on fetishism and, if possible, extremely expensive fetishes. Of course, you can't sell a cartoon for $1 billion, but changes many things. If you look quickly at the wall cartoons made by Berejovsky, you can find many connections with Reinhardt. You find puns about aesthetic debate. Thanks God I am a conceptual artist. Sometimes you have a political background, difference between local art and international art. And sometimes you have, at the same moment, an extremely poetic but still political feeling. I like that one. And I like that one too. And here is one of my favorites. That's a perfect example. You can write more than 30 or even 30,000 pages on the delocalization problem, world lawless capitalism, unemployment difficulties, and how to combat such a sad situation. Here, everything is said in 2 seconds. The situation, our helplessness toward the situation, our anger too. We are all angry about the situation. And all that is not said, not shown, but said and shown with that kind of humor. You always find, that's my opinion, you can discuss that, of course, but you always find that kind of humor on the loser side, and winners are rarely funny. Losers have much more humor, because it's a necessity for a loser to live, to keep on living the humor. In conclusion, I try to make it short. I would like to quote another interview by Dan Perjovsky. I'm sure that his choice of what I propose to call the cartoon paradigm is related to his origin, born in Romania, and is the typical, is in the typical situation of the insider, outsider. Is just rescued from one of the craziest totalitarianisms in Europe, and waiting to be accepted in a capitalist Western Europe system that was maybe not so attractive, that people in the Eastern Europe originally imagined. And that's what he says. As an outsider, one is helped and encouraged. As an insider, one is part of the club. The good news is that we don't need imported paper for all our art, in Romania, of course. The bad news is that the little exoticism we had is gone. I go for an optimistic viewpoint. More idea exchanges will occur. Let's see who gets the dividends. I would like to share his optimism. I'm not sure to share it. Thank you for your attention, and I apologize for my awful French accent. If you have some questions.